The real property legal description is, does anyone know where we find the legal description of the property? Do we have? Oh, from April to everyone. Congratulations, April. You are correct. The deed. Remember I told you where to find it? Property appraiser site, sales history. I urge you to check the deed even if your auto-populating with the property appraiser or tax collector's legal, because sometimes they're not correct. Even if it's a lot and block, just check it. The legal description and the purchase price are the two most important elements of the contract. It's the consideration given which sustains the contract. We had a situation years ago out of Plant City where the realtors put just the property ID number. They did not include a legal description. Unbeknownst to us, the seller had recently done a property split. We didn't know that. Our closer, and I love to tell this part, who happened to be Aaron Davis, the owner of the Florida Agency Network Title Companies, he put the legal description contained on the last deed of record. It was a 4-acre parcel. The seller intended to retain 1 acre and convey 3 acres. He had no way to know that. So next November comes around, the seller doesn't get a tax bill for their 1 acre. They called Aaron, and Aaron said, no problem, I'll call the buyer and get a deed. And Aaron called the buyer, and everyone can guess what the buyer said. No, I'm not giving the acre back to the seller. Litigation, and I mean years of litigation, ensued. This conveyance happened in about 2007. We went to trial in 2013. All of the evidence was that the seller intended to retain the 1 acre. Both realtors testified that the seller intended to retain the 1 acre. And by the way, during this time period, the seller sued us, alleging the diminished value of the property, because if we think about what happened from 2007 to 2013, property values took a nosedive. So the judge awarded the acre back to the seller, awarded attorney's fees and costs against the buyer. The buyer promptly filed bankruptcy, and the sellers never collected their fees and costs. After the trial, we were sitting with the judge, the lawyers were sitting with the judge, and the judge's first question was, why didn't anybody sue the realtors? He said, they started this whole problem by negligently preparing the contract. They didn't include a legal description. And the answer was, Judge, I begged Aaron Davis to sue those realtors. I'd have sued their socks off. But that's the difference between a businessman and a lawyer. Aaron Davis is a businessman. Jim Holloway is a lawyer. He wouldn't sue the realtors. But the judge certainly thought they should be sued. So that's how important the legal description is. Paragraph 1D, personal property, unless excluded in paragraph 1E. It lists the items that are conveyed with the home. Window coverings, curtains. You'd be surprised how many people take their curtains, and they should be conveyed unless you exclude them in paragraph 1E. Light fixtures. Several years ago, we had a situation here in South Tampa. A seller had a Bayshore Boulevard, naturally, had a beautiful dining room fixture. Buyer does the walkthrough, the dining room fixture's hanging there. Buyer comes back to move into the house, dining room fixture is gone. Where's the fixture? The seller took it. The seller had an email. Does anyone know what the E in email stands for? Anyone? It's evidence. The seller had an email where he had told the realtor that he wanted to exclude the dining room fixture, and the realtor failed to put it in paragraph 1E. Turns out it was about a $15,000 to $20,000 fixture. Who bought the seller a new fixture? Yes, the realtor's carrier. So be very careful. The number one thing that the seller, other thing that the seller takes with them, the pool equipment. It's not included in paragraph 1D. And I'm talking about the pool suite that runs around the bottom of the pool and picks up the leaves and dirt and so forth. It's about a $500 piece of equipment. Seller takes it, buyer moves in, their first call is to their realtor. Where's the pool equipment? Oh, I forgot to put it in paragraph 1D, and the seller is entitled to take it. So walk around the home with your seller, ask them what they want to keep. Walk around the home with your buyer, ask them what they want to go with the home. Purchase price, that's pretty easy. We can get the purchase price. Earnest money deposit. I like to use the 3 days after the effective date. Keep effective date in your mind. We're going to talk about it in just a minute. I don't like to have a check floating around accompanying a contract that hasn't been fully executed. Whose responsibility is it to make sure that the earnest money deposit is timely made? The buyer's agent. We had a situation years ago. Excuse me. On a situation several years ago, it was during the crash. A buyer put a contract on a little tiny piece of property on the Pinellas side of the Gandy Bridge, called for a $500 deposit. 6 months later, the listing agent called the title company and said, "Hey, do you still have that $500 deposit?" Title company said, "We never got a $500 deposit." Listing agent turned the buyer's agent into Freck. Buyer's agent, over $500 deposit, had to hire a lawyer, spent about $5,000 hiring a lawyer, went to Orlando to a hearing, was suspended for 30 days. I was shocked. Over $500 deposit. Apparently, Freck takes the deposit very seriously. An earnest money deposit is not a down payment and should not be treated as a down payment. The buyer's deposit is at risk the minute they write the check. It's at risk because the state of Florida puts a very onerous burden on the escrow agent. If the parties can't agree who gets the money, the only thing the escrow agent can do legally is file a lawsuit called an interpleader. An interpleader says, "Judge, it's either his money or her money. I've got the money. Who do I give the money to?" The problem with an interpleader is lawyers are expensive. Yay! If it's $1,000, $2,000, $3,000, we're not going to make it to the courthouse door before the money's gone. You know, $400 or $500 an hour, it doesn't take many hours before you've spent up all the money. So most of the time, if we can't resolve the dispute, and I'm happy to make an effort to resolve the dispute, most of the time, it's a bright line. Either the buyer canceled within a contingency period, or they did not cancel within a contingency period. If they canceled within the contingency, they get their money back. If they didn't, they don't. The biggest refrain I hear from buyers is, it wasn't my fault, it was my lender's fault. I've read paragraph 8B 10,000 times, and nowhere in paragraph 8B, that's the financing contingency, does it say, unless it's the buyer's fault. It's the buyer's obligation to know when their contingencies expire and to take action one way or the other before the expiration of the contingency period. I really like the concept of paragraph 2B, the additional deposit. If you want to make a stronger offer after the contingencies have expired, you've got your loan in place, you've had the inspection, put down more money. If you're, it's still a very competitive market out there. I understand that. But we've had situations in the past where tens of thousands of dollars have gone one way or the other. You know, on a house that was selling for $300,000. And I think you should let your buyer know that, you know, their money could be at risk the minute they put it down. Financing, usually express it as a percentage. And then the other, that's the loan from mom and dad, or the gift from mom and dad, and then balance to close and collected funds.